It has to do with particular historical and cultural circumstances. A lot of it developed in Paris. In fact, what Bricon and Sauquel are talking about is Paris irrationalism. And if you look at the history of French culture since the Second World War, it's kind of, it has some strange characteristics. Say, let's take the 1970s when this began to blossom. The French intellectuals were the last Stalinists, dedicated Stalinists. I mean, some of them were shaken a little by 1956, but if they weren't Stalinists, they were Maoists. I mean, I remember, I don't know if it's fair to mention names, but say, Kristeva, I happened to meet in the mid-70s, flaming Maoist, and it was pretty common all the way through. The French intellectuals have a, there's a history in France which is, has justification that they're somehow at the peak of cultural life. So they have to be in whatever they're doing, that's what's important. In fact, France is an extremely insular culture, always has been. It everything is in France, nothing is anywhere else. Anything that's anywhere else doesn't matter. So for example, it takes a, some other domain, logical positivism. I mean, it spread over the world in the 20s, 30s. By the 1950s and 60s, it had been sort of assimilated into other currents. It wasn't a passionate ideology anymore. It never even reached France. The first translations into French, of course, of work of the, say, Vienna positivists, it was actually in the 1980s. And it was from a young French philosopher, Pierre Jacob, who came to Boston, learned about it, and came back and translated work from the 1930s and 40s, which by then had kind of mostly been forgotten in the West and was just being revived in Paris. It's even true in fields like in the sciences. I mean, they have a rich tradition in some areas, but say, I remember about 30 years ago or so, there was an article in some science journal discussing the history of the acceptance of evolutionary theory, sorry, Darwinian evolutionary theory, as it spread around the world, and it pretty much the same course. You know, some resistance finally overcame it. By the time the article was written, it was a standard scientific doctrine everywhere, with one exception: France. A large number of the professional biologists were still pre-Darwinian. This didn't seem plausible to me, so I asked a friend who's a Nobel laureate in biology, who got his education in France, in fact. I asked him, does that make any sense? And he just laughed. He said the only reason it isn't 100% true is that Jacques Monod had been in the resistance. And as a reward for his resistance service, he was granted a small laboratory. And out of that laboratory came all of the great French modern biology, Monod, Jacob, other great biologists. But that little item. Well, this gets back to the Stalinism and Maoism of the 1970s. That suddenly collapsed. One of the things that caused it to collapse was Solzhenitsyn's Gulag. It was translated in France, big sensation. All of a sudden, everyone became a passionate anti-communist. And since it's Paris, they had to be the first ones who ever discovered it. So I remember going there and hearing from leading intellectuals things I knew when I was 10 years old, because you know, we were reading it then, you know. But it was all new, discovered, and they had to have something novel. Well, what do you do that's novel? I should add another feature of Paris cultural life. The French intellectuals tend to be, vedette, and they're media stars. So they're French intellectuals are taken very seriously. They're on the front pages of Le Monde and so on. It's probably not a good thing. But if you want to be taken seriously, you have to have something exciting to say. Like a movie star, you know, or a television figure. And it's not easy to come up with exciting new ideas. So you have to come up with crazy ideas. And then they can make it to the front pages. And this is kind of what went on. One of the ways to have exciting new ideas is to tear everything to shreds and say everything was wrong. You know, the Enlightenment was wrong. There's no foundationalism. They're right. There's no foundationalism. That was known in the 17th century. But they had to rediscover it and put it in a fancy way and so on and so forth. Well, out of this comes this irrational tendency, which was very welcome in many areas because it did undermine dedicated activism. I happened to be in Paris a couple of months ago, about a year ago, I guess, giving talks. And one of them was a big political talk organized by Le Monde Diplomatique. And good usual discussion, questions from the floor and so on. One young man got up, I forget whether you were there for this. Yeah, he had a rather plaintive question. He said, Bertrand Russell tells us we should look for the truth, but the philosophers tell us there is no truth. So what should we do? The philosophers means the fashionable people who call themselves philosophers in France. Well, you don't hear that kind of thing anywhere else in the world, except where this influence has spread. And it has spread to intellectual circles in much of the world. In the United States, for example, it's mostly confined to comparative literature departments. So if they talk to each other in incomprehensible rhetoric, nobody cares. The place where it's been really harmful is in the third world, because third world intellectuals are badly needed in the popular movements. They can make contributions. And a lot of them are just drawn away from this. Anthropologists, sociologists, and others, they're drawn away into these arcane, in my view, mostly meaningless discourses, and are dissociated from popular struggles. And you can see the impact. I mean, I've had experiences around the third world. It's kind of unfair, maybe I won't even talk about them, but they really indicate how the level of irrationality that grows out of this undermines the opportunities for doing something really significant and important. I mean, you know, rationality is it's a tool that you better have if you want to achieve anything. You might as well have some grasp of what the real world is like. If you give up on that, you can be an easy victim for any outside force. It is kind of like consumerism. It diverts people from concentrating in a serious way on doing something about their own problems, real problems.